If Venmo was built today, Venmo would be built purely with stablecoins and crypto rails.
You can imagine a future where the cost of creating customized financial instruments just continues to drop.
In the world of most efficient practice will be the long-term winner. Do you think stablecoins would replace this correspondent banking framework?
Cross-border, you're actually seeing a lot of stablecoin transactions happening at scale.
Welcome to Interconnected, a YouTube series and podcast that pulls back the curtain on the digital infrastructure powering today's biggest tech trends. I'm Glenn Deckhazer.
And I'm Adrian Mount Stevens.
Today, we're talking about the future of money. For centuries, banks and exchanges have been the central hubs that make financial systems work. But blockchain and Web3, they're changing the rules.
Yeah, Glenn, stablecoins are turning dollars into programmable digital cash that moves across borders in seconds. Crypto exchanges, both centralized and decentralized, are becoming the marketplaces of a new digital asset economy. And building this system takes more than software. It requires networks, servers, serious compute, and storage, infrastructure that can keep this digital money available to everyone all the time.
And later in this episode, we'll be talking about these infrastructure aspects with a couple of the leading builders in this space. But first, we're setting the stage with Sheila Warren, CEO of the Project Liberty Institute, and one of the leading voices in blockchain and digital policy. Previously, she served as the inaugural CEO of the Crypto Council for Innovation, the premier global alliance advancing responsible crypto innovation worldwide, where she still remains an advisor. She'll help us with the big picture of how this megatrend is reshaping money itself. Sheila, thank you so much for spending time with us today. The times, they are a-changing, so we're lucky to have you here to help folks navigate that change.
Sure, and thanks for having me here. It's always fun to explain this moment in time, which is multifaceted for sure.
Well, I guess let's start with the big picture. How should we think about blockchain and Web3? Not just as a technology, but as a force that's reshaping how money works compared to traditional financial systems?
So I think when you think about TradFi, it's really predicated on a lot of trust in a centralized actor to keep a reliable record of debits and credits and what's flowing through. So right now, if we were to go out for drinks and I wanted to send you my portion of the drinks and you accepted that, we would go to our phones, most likely, and we would pick our service provider, Venmo, PayPal, whatever it was. Boom, Zappo, you'd have some money and I would have less money, right? That works because we trust that my bank is talking to the centralized provider, whatever it is of choice, is talking to your bank, and they are accurately debiting and crediting our accounts. What if you couldn't rely on any of that? What's an alternative way of creating a record of that transaction? That is what a blockchain does.
Okay. Well, I've heard the term stablecoin, and stablecoins have quickly become one of the most talked about applications of blockchain. Where do they fit into this picture, and how do you think they'll be used?
So right now, if we're going to exchange that transaction I just talked about, we'd use fiat money, right? But what are alternatives to fiat money? What if there are places where the transaction fee on exchange of fiat is really high? So let's say you're in one country, I'm in a different country. We need to get our banks to talk to each other. But to do that, they have to hop through six other banks. And every bank along that hop, on that journey, takes a cut. It's difficult for me to be sending money, let's say, to myself in a different country without getting a massive haircut on that. And it's very slow. So what stablecoins enable is basically instantaneous transfer of financial value across a variety of different ledgers. Unlike a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin or Ethereum, stablecoins' value is pegged to a stable asset, and the asset can vary. In the Genius case, these are fiat collateralized stablecoins that are tied to the US dollar or to fiat currency. It's not entirely clear, you know, which form factor is going to be prevalent. And I think it's going to depend on the sector that you're in. Cross-border, you're actually seeing a lot, ironically, of stablecoin transactions happening at scale. People are moving fiat into a USDC, for example, and they're moving that back out into something else because the settlement is instantaneous.
Yeah, what you described there is really interesting. The traditional finance way of moving money from one country to another, as you say, requires a lot of complexity, but is also at scale and mature and works. What we're suggesting is stablecoins can do it potentially in real time and with less fees. So in the world of the most efficient practice will be the long-term winner, do you think stablecoins would replace this really complex but well-established banking framework for cross-border?
Yeah, it's kind of one of the questions a lot of people are asking. And my answer to that is no. I think it's going to become another mechanism for engaging in cross-border transactions because at scale, at massive amounts of money, people are going to want to rely on, you know, insurance and all these other mechanisms that are still to be built in the stablecoin ecosystem. For small exchanges of value, I think you're going to see tremendous movement into stablecoins, which already exists because you don't get the massive fee of the haircut, right? And of the instantaneous nature of the payment that makes these things much more viable and practical for people on the ground.
You know, so talking about the people on the ground, a lot of people, you know, hear that, okay, the governments are going to start getting into cryptocurrencies, stablecoins are not. And of course, a lot of these folks don't really understand the world. And I was one of those. So can we talk about the difference between a centralized and a decentralized exchange? Because I think for legacy infrastructure folks like us, it matters. Does it?
Yes and no. Your position on this is going to depend on a couple of things. One is how much trust you put in any institution versus true peer-to-peer engagement. Okay. The next is how much do you think privacy matters? And I think we're in a world, I would argue, where privacy is increasingly, I've always thought privacy was deeply important. It's embedded in my sort of, you know, DNA, if you want to call it that.
Ours too.
I think a lot about differential privacy, and that's who needs to know what.
Differential privacy. I like that.
Right. So that's going to become very easy to engage with online. And as we move into a world of AI agents, how are you thinking about what the agent needs to know to verify that you can proceed in a system? And it's usually a very specific and small piece of information. So what decentralized exchanges take advantage of is this instantaneous peer-to-peer relationship. You don't need an intermediator to determine that it's a legitimate transaction or pairing or whatever. The code can do that.
Yeah. So let me ask you a question. So 5 years ahead, that's almost impossible to ask that question anymore. But, you know, let's go for it. 5 years, where do you see this?
Yeah. I do think we're going to move into a world where everybody owns a digital wallet. You know, we kind of have this sort of today without really realizing it.
Right here.
Right? Yeah, there it is. But we're going to be more conscious of our digital wallet, what's in our digital wallet. It's going to be identification of various kinds. Again, this differential privacy. Small transactions run in almost exclusively peer-to-peer manner. Because again, you're going to have enough trust and the risk is not high if you're trading $20 back and forth. It's going to feel more like cash, but digitally, right? Than when you're trying to, you know, buy a house. Insurance is going to be a huge factor in a lot of this. If you have an agent engaging in commercial transactions for you, what is the fiduciary obligation they have, right? Moving to a world where it is becoming of paramount importance, I think the responsibilities of developers in this space is really seminal and critical to how this is going to evolve too.
So that's the big picture of where digital money is headed. Now, let's go deeper into the infrastructure, stablecoins, exchanges, and the bridges that connect them.
We're joined by two builders who live this every day. Dan Reeser is the CEO of the Wormhole Foundation, who focuses on blockchain interoperability and decentralized finance. And with him is Ray Chiang, co-founder and CTO of Gauntlet, who works on the systems that keep decentralized markets secure and stable.
Ray and Dan, thank you so much for spending time with us today. We want to do a little bit of a deep dive on crypto exchanges here. But first question to Dan, from your perspective, what are the key differences between centralized and decentralized exchanges?
So centralized exchange, they actually own your assets. So in the worst case scenario, if there's a hack or if they lose your money, there's nothing you can do because it's their money actually at the end of the day before you withdraw. The difference between that and the decentralized exchange, which we often call a DEX for short, is that a decentralized exchange is not owned by any one person or entity. You own your assets. They just provide the website and the infrastructure for you to do your trades. But at the end of the day, you're keeping control of your money.
So traditional exchanges, they require high security, right? I would imagine regulatory compliance, data sovereignty, which is a big thing over here. Usually there's low latency networks for electronic trading. There's an ecosystem of buyers and sellers. Are crypto exchanges any different?
I mean, fundamentally, crypto exchanges are dealing with a lot of the kind of same problems that you need to solve on the traditional exchange. So if you're trading a stock in your in your brokerage account, you're going through a broker that then routes orders possibly through some market makers before it finally hits an exchange like the NASDAQ or the New York Stock Exchange. With centralized crypto exchanges like Coinbase, for example, there's not really like this separate broker layer. You typically just go directly onto Coinbase's website and place your orders directly on the exchange. That places a higher burden on the exchange for making sure all parts of their system are operating kind of correctly, including the security and custody of funds. And for decentralized exchanges, they're able to kind of offload that responsibility custody onto the user. And so that comes down to the user being responsible for managing their funds with, you know, again, like a wallet like MetaMask or via some type of hardware wallet solution.
So question for Dan, do you think that any hybrid models could emerge, blending centralized trust with decentralized rails? I mean, is maybe that where stable coins come in, maybe?
Yeah, this is actually what I was about to say. I think companies are actually going to drive traditional markets to have to become 24/7 to even compete with centralized and decentralized exchanges. Coinbase and Robinhood are both two great examples because both have actually announced their plans to launch a blockchain. Coinbase's blockchain called Base is already live, and Robinhood's blockchain hasn't launched yet, but will be launching, I think, somewhere in the near future, probably the next 2 quarters.
Yeah, it is definitely interesting to see kind of the roadmap starting to overlap in some sense, like coming at it from different directions. So kind of back to the original question of these hybrid architectures, I think we've definitely seen the market structure in crypto and DeFi or decentralized finance become a lot more sophisticated, you know, over the last 5 years or so. In early days of Ethereum and DeFi, people just wanted to encode all the logic, all the rules directly on chain. But people quickly found out that that was not the scalable solution, especially when there's, you know, limited capacity on the blockchain to process, you know, transactions. And so now a lot of venues have this kind of hybrid model where they are leaning on the blockchain for settlements of trades, if you will. But a lot of the actual like order book or order matching is actually done, you know, with essentially just off-chain systems.
So I'll put this in the context of the Genius Act. How are businesses and institutions likely to begin using stablecoins in this new environment from a technical perspective, right? From compliance, use of APIs and bridges and stuff like that?
Yeah, so I guess maybe just to cover real quick what the Genius Act is. So Genius Act is an acronym for Guiding and Establishing National Innovation for U.S. Stablecoins. There's a few key kind of parts of the act. One starts with establishing reserve requirements for US dollar stablecoins. And so that means the collateral for the stablecoin has to be, you know, in a high quality liquid asset. That typically means dollars or things like short-term treasuries. It also kind of gives some guidance on reserve transparency and reporting rules, so people kind of know what collateral is backing the stablecoin. And then also starts to paint a picture of the legal or regulatory framework for stablecoins. Definitely a pretty big milestone in terms of, you know, pushing stablecoins more into the mainstream. But then, of course, that also comes with a higher cost for registration and compliance with the new legislation as well.
Yeah, Ray, and it's interesting, right? We talked a bit about Coinbase and Robinhood. I think part of their vision will be to unlock some of the potential of the Genius Act, put stablecoins onto that blockchain, integrate that into their portfolio, and use the stablecoins to allow people to move money in and out of wallets and in and out of the exchanges that they're running. So something like Tether allows someone in any country in the world to basically hold US dollars and use them to move money around, right? It's that powerful. But a traditional finance payment rail like credit or debit cards is covered in compliance and regulation and security. There's an awful lot of diligence around the infrastructure that moves credit and debit card payments around the world. Would that same need now need to be applied to stablecoin, that same sort of rigor around the infrastructure to make sure that it's secure?
Yeah, I mean, I think one benefit of the regulation is it makes it clear the bar that, you know, stablecoin issuers need to clear in terms of types of collateral and as well as, you know, transparency on reporting.
And a stablecoin is just a digital representation of a dollar, but it's very important to understand that every stablecoin that's issued has to be backed by either a dollar or a US Treasury bill somewhere in an account. And the reason why this is important is because there was a little bit of gray area as far as what is exactly backing each of these dollars that's issued on the blockchain. With the Genius Act, there's clear requirements and frameworks that these companies can follow to know exactly how they need to be operating. And everyone's happy with regulation. The crypto industry has been asking for regulation for the last 5 to 10 years. And now that there's finally rules for people to follow, people can simply just follow the law and grow their businesses in a way that they know won't be adding risk to their future.
So I guess, how are people going to move tokens safely across chains and link into TradFi banks and payment networks? What are they going to have to do from an infrastructure perspective, network perspective, security perspective to comply with all of the existing constructs that they have to work with today?
Yeah, so I think from a core technology perspective, all the major pieces are kind of already in place for stablecoins to support a good portion of global payments and transfers. So if you look at it from the perspective of pure kind of network scalability, a lot of the latest generation layer 2 and new layer 1 blockchains are kind of on the order, same order of magnitude in terms of transaction throughput as, say, like a Visa. So for reference, Visa, you know, averages about on the order of 2,000 transactions per second with kind of peak load on the order of like, you know, 50,000. So this, like, you know, single digit thousands of transactions per second is kind of where the state of the art layer 1 and layer 2 blockchains are currently. And, you know, with additional improvements, you know, there's definitely still more headroom to increase there. But, you know, from like a raw tech perspective, you know, there's a lot of engineering and improvements that have gone into kind of different bridge architectures and interoperability between the different chains. But, you know, there is still a lot of work remaining to kind of integrate with, you know, the real world. Like up until now, blockchains and decentralized finance are, you know, kind of operating in a bit of a closed system where most of the assets and all the rules are encoded on chain. But now you're trying to merge this into the traditional financial system. There's just a lot of adapters and off-chain business logic and, you know, laws that need to be followed. You know, everything from figuring out better custody solutions to kind of more institutional grade custody, accounting, tax solutions. There's also just better, you know, fiat on-ramps that are needed for various markets to integrations with, you know, point of sale systems. And then on the flip side for merchants, you know, they need to be able to figure out how to do the accounting, pay their local suppliers in local currency if they are starting to do more business in stablecoins. So just a lot of different places where things need to be plugged into legacy systems.
It sounds like we're in a really exciting time for this technology, right? Maybe we're just on the cusp of what you've described of that big integration between traditional finance and these new sort of crypto-based technologies.
Yeah, we are. I think one example that'll help paint the picture for people to understand this integration of traditional finance and these crypto rails. As you were saying, Adrian, there's millions of people that live in the US who want to send money back to their home. If it's $100, at the end, they can probably expect around $85 to get home. With crypto, you would on-ramp your $100 into Coinbase, for example. You would send 100 USDC from your crypto wallet to your family member's crypto wallet in Argentina, for example. And then on that exchange, you would just simply trade USDC for the Argentinian peso. That exchange fee would probably be between $1 and $3. So your family member would receive $97 versus $85 at best. And this is all using exchanges and stablecoins.
So let's talk about the future. 5 years from now, where do you see this industry? How far have we come? What can we do that we couldn't do before? And what do you think comes after that?
Yeah, 5 years from now, the number of stablecoins out in the world right now is 167 billion.
Wow.
Which is bigger than the GDP of Morocco.
Yeah.
Just one stablecoin. So I think one thing we're going to see in the next 5 years is a 10x minimum in the number of stablecoins that are out there in the world. That's going to be driven by businesses, banks, and institutional people. The other one is adoption from the everyday person using some sort of crypto rail without even realizing that they're using crypto. If Venmo was built today, Venmo would be built purely with stablecoins and crypto rails.
Definitely agree with both those points. In addition to that, I think the cost of creating new financial products is kind of non-trivial, right? Because right now, when some company comes out with some new financial product, it kind of just takes a while for them to establish a track record for you to kind of believe that what they're, you know, doing is correct, et cetera. But if everything is, you know, built in the open, it's a lot easier to verify. Because of the composable and transparent nature of a lot of on-chain and decentralized finance, you can create a new financial product just by writing some new code, and everyone can see exactly what it does. And so that decreases the cost of implementation, but it also really short circuits the cost of trust, if you will. Imagine a future where the cost of creating these customized financial instruments just continues to drop substantially.
Huge thanks to our guests for helping us unpack how blockchain is fueling the rise of borderless finance. We've seen how stablecoins, crypto exchanges, and infrastructure are converging with traditional finance to reshape how value moves globally.
Yeah, stay tuned for the next episode of Interconnected, where we'll explore another megatrend shaping our digital future. You can find us on YouTube and wherever you listen to podcasts.